So in this talk, we are going to talk about authentication, right? So I think everyone heard this term, strong authentication, right? So if you are a financial sector, or if you are in banking or healthcare, so there are various specification and industry standards where they mention about strong authentication. First, let's look at why authentication need to be that strong. Isn't that having a username and password good enough? Right? So let's see. OK, the first, let me give you some of the stats. These are I copied from the Verizon data breach investigation report from 2017, last year. So according to them, 70% of employees reuse their password, right? And 59% of employees reuse their password everywhere. That means they use the same password at office, they use the same in the home, they use the same in the Facebook, whatever places, right? And further, among the hacking related to various data breaches, 81% of are caused with the weak password. So you can understand the problem we are in, right? So that means basically we can conclude a password are no longer a secure method for authentication, even though we all are still use, right? So that's my first reason. Second one, CIA, that is somewhat familiar area for us as we mainly work on CIAM related area. So in CIAM, there are several features in, if you want to build a CIAM solution. SSO, so basically SSO enable your users, it could be your employees or your end users, they can seamlessly logging into various applications without re-authentication. So it greatly enhanced user experience. In the same time, it greatly increased the risk. Why? If an attacker managed to access to one web application, or if an attacker managed to log in into one application, he can access to all other applications as well. So that is the downside. So then we have to think about how to make the authentication strong. There's another use case, bring your own identity. So everyone is familiar with there is a problem in CIAM called registration spaghetti. That means whenever people visit to some website, they ask registration. It's a kind of anti-pattern. Now we, instead of that, now we have bring your own identity, where people can bring their existing digital identity. The most popular option is bring that identity from social network. In such a scenarios, before you onboard such identity, you have to make sure that that identity provider or the party that manage that identity, probably a social network, has properly authenticate this user. Third one, API security. I think next session we are going to look at most of these token types and etc. So in API security, you will get several types of tokens. Basically ID token, that is basically to get the user information. Then you get access token, that is basically to access the backend API. Then, most important to me, the refresh token. So what's the purpose of the refresh token? So when a client or application get refresh token, the application can get a new access token whenever the current access token get expired. Right? So this is the cycle of getting a new access token, then it get expired and getting that. So that is, in that way, the refresh token greatly enhanced the end user experience and also client to server integration, but in the same time, it enhanced the security. It's not the chance of security beat, because once somebody get all these three token type, they can keep on access the API. So that again raise the problem, or as again raise a requirement to for the strong authentication. Another fact is regulation. For example, GDPR. In GDPR, it says so whenever you store personal information, you have to make sure this information can be accessed only with very strong security measurements. It could be your employees, or it could be end user. But you have to provide a maximum security. Then PSD2. PSD2 also emphasizes such security requirement. And also, in PSD2, according to PSD, you should be able to provide various security levels, or we call it as various assurance of security. For example, let's say if a transaction amount, if it is less than, let's say, 35 euros, then you may go with just simple authentication. But if it is less than 35 euros or somewhere around that, then you need to think about additional security measurement. So these are some security standards. Then level of assurance. So for example, healthcare application. Assume if you just want to log into healthcare application, maybe you need a simple security or simple authentication approach. But when you want to download your the medical reports to this application, maybe it accepts additional security, something like that. So these are, I think now you have some understanding about why we need a strong authentication. So how do you support that? The requirements are there, how to support that? So the answer is, the way we should follow is basically, in addition to your password, that's a simple username password, you need to bring some two-factor verification. So I just use the two-step verification because that is widely used, but it could be two-step or three-step. You can go to N level, right? So basically, the answer is implement multi-factor authentication. So this is the approach. So you break authentication into multiple steps. For the simplicity, let's take two steps. So in the first step, you verify one set of factors. In second step, you validate or you verify a different set of factors. So we call that authentication factors. So what are these authentication factors? So there are three types. There are three types of authentication factors. First, we call it as knowledge. That is something user know or something you know. It could be password, passphrase, PIN, or something, some kind of a knowledge, right? Second fact is possession. That is something you have. It could be your phone. It could be some hardware token, badge, some kind of a smart card, etc. Third one is inherence. That is something you are. That could be a fingerprint, that could be some facial feature, or it could be your voice, etc. So these are the three factors. So in order to make a strong authentication, you need to, at least you need to combine two factors, right? For example, if I take example, there is no point to have in the first factor, you ask your Facebook username password. In second step, you may ask your Twitter. So is it a good security measurement? No, because in both steps, we evaluate knowledge or something you have. Instead of that, in order to become a strong authentication, you have to pick two from three of this group. For example, this is a good example. In step one, either user can pick email or Facebook. In second step, user could pick either FIDO or Google OTP. So what's the do we have a perfect solution here? So I would say this is, if you use two factors, at least for 90% cases, this is secure enough. In security world, there is no like perfect solution, but most of the cases, this is good enough. So now let's look at the reality. So let's listen to Google. So according to Google, among their users, only 10% of Google users have enabled the two-factor authentication. So that is very interesting. The second thing is, that is more interesting, there is a news website called The Register. They conduct a survey from their users. They ask, according to you, how percentage or how many of Gmail users have enabled two-factor authentication? So if I ask you, what do you think? So surprisingly, among the people who attend this survey, 68% believe only 1 to 10% of Gmail users have enabled two-factor authentication. So that is interesting. So this is factually correct, and also this is what people believe. So we have a nearly perfect solution, but people don't use it. So what's the problem? So we can come up with a solution like people are not educated, or people don't realize the actual problem here, and so on. But is it the right answer? So what's the problem here? The problem here, a traditional problem between convenience and security. So if you increase the security, that will reduce the convenience, right? So how do we come up with the solution? The solution is the authentication need to be more dynamic, more responsive, and more context sensitive. In other words, we can call this as an adaptive authentication, right? So let me take a few use cases, right? Okay. Let's take somebody called imaginary Alex. So now Alex log into a system using London. That is his usual place, using username and password. So after 20 hours, the same user, the Alex, trying to log into the same system from New York or San Francisco, right? So the time between these two logins, 20 hours, right? So this is kind of a suspicious situation. The first is, this is not his default location. Second one is, the time duration between these two logins is 20. So now, your identity system should able to evaluate these factors and increase the security. So when he logged in to the system from London, he only used username and password. Now he's trying to log in from San Francisco. Then the system can ask additional factor. For example, at that time, system can ask for FIDO device authentication or Google authentication or something like that. So this is we called as geo-velocity, right? So I took 20 hours as an example. So what happened if it is a 5 minutes? Let's say Alex login from London. After 5 minutes, Alex tried to log in from San Francisco. What should you, or should the system offer a second factor? No. I think in that place, unless it's a ghost or someone with a Superman or some that kind of super person, nobody can travel from London to United States within 5 minutes. Then, in such a scenario, system should block the user. Block user and notify the system administrators and so on. There is something going on within the system. So these are one adaptive use case. The second one is, as I described earlier, healthcare application. So somebody can log into healthcare application and just look at the reports and so on. But at the time, a user try to download this medical report, the application can ask for additional securities. So this is common in healthcare. And also this is common in some banking application. So you can log into a bank application and you can check your balance, etc. But when you try to transfer some money from your bank account to somebody else, at that time, banking application can ask for additional security measurements. So in such a situation also, your identity system should be able to accept this additional security request and give additional factors. The third one, the new devices. So usually, we usually use one laptop or few laptops or our phone. So in such a scenario, the system should learn. This is the default devices. And in such a situation, username password may be good enough. Whenever a user try to log in from a different device, then the identity system can offer a second factor. So that is another use case, right? So far, I think I described what are the adaptive use cases. Now let's look at how to implement or what we have done in WSO2. So this is our offering. So we have two parts. The first, we have a way of scripting. So you can script what are the conditions. For example, in my previous use case, I used like if the location of is this, or if it is a new device, right? Like that, you have some conditions, if and then conditions. So you can script. So you have now we offer a mechanism in such a way that you can control the authentication flow. So until Identity Server 570, you have multi-factor authentication. You can go to n number of authentication steps, and you can have any number of authentication options, but it is not dynamic, or you cannot change it according to the context or attended to user attribute. But now you have that. For example, within the authentication script, you can define set of if and else statement. And under each statement, you can evaluate various factors. And depend on that, you can decide whether the system going to prompt for second factor, third factor, and so on. And also, this is combined with our very strong authentication connector library. So we have supported FIDO, Duo, Google. So if you look at our connector store, there are more than 50 connectors available, industry-ready connectors. So if you combine this scripting ability with our connectors, so you can build a powerful adaptive authentication system. So these are some possibilities. The first one is I'm not going to discuss. That is pretty much a static authentication flow that we used to have. Still, that is possible. Second one is request-based conditional authentication. That means if you look at any login request, there are some context or background information from where this request originated, IP address, right, and so on. So based on these the properties or attribute of this request, you can decide an authentication step. Like I mentioned, if the IP is unknown, or if it is the IP range is not usual IP range, you can prompt for additional security measurement. So this is called request-based conditional authentication flow. The second one is user-based conditional authentication flow. For example, using username or password, using first step, you can identify the user. So once you identify the user, you can evaluate his properties or attribute. Basically, what are the roles this user has, like that. Based on this attribute of user, you can prompt for additional security. That is what we call as user-based conditional authentication. Then, third one, and that is the very complex one, we call as adaptive or risk-based authentication flow. So far, in previous three cases, we just need identity server. That means if you have WSO identity server, that is good enough to implement all these scenarios. But in fourth one, you need something additional. You need some streaming processor, some kind of a machine learner to provide the risk score. So basically, what we do is, whenever somebody tries to log in, we publish this information into this engine. This, let's say, streaming processor, some kind of an engine. We publish all our information into this engine. And if there are some other application, they also can publish to this centralized engine, risk engine. Then, whenever somebody tries to log in, we ask this risk engine, what is the risk score? What is the risk score for this current user? Then it provides the risk score is 1, 2, 3, like that. So based on this risk score, identity server can prompt additional security. So it not only the offer some second factor, third factor authentication, in addition to that, it can block the user, or it can notify the administrator, like that. Using these script capabilities, you can achieve all these use cases. By default, we ship with our identity server 5.7, we ship with the streaming processor. So that is our default streaming processor. But technically, we can integrate it with any CEP or streaming processor, machine learner, etc. For example, we are talking with one prospect. They interest to integrate with TensorFlow. So, OK, I think this time I'm a bit very quick, yeah. So in conclusion, so now everyone knows passwords are no longer secure. So that is a norm. Then the multi-factor authentication offer a perfect solution. So we know, as a technically, the multi-factor offer a multi-factor authentication offer a perfect solution, but the problem is usability. But if you use adaptive authentication, you can get the best out of both worlds. It's a secure and also it is convenient for your users. As a last point, the WSO2 Identity Server can offer you a very comprehensive level of adaptive or risk-based authentication. OK, yeah. So that's what I want to cover with this talk. Thank you.
So we actually have about 7 minutes before we start our next session. If you have any questions, we can take them now. You have a question from that table over there.
So I want to have a solution, a kitchen where I want to allow people to see part of the data using a username and password. But when they go to a deeper level, I want them to use two factor like Google or Microsoft authenticating on their phone. Could I do that?
Yeah, you can do that. That is pretty much identical to my example with
Absolutely. The
banking.
What
yeah.
I do is a combination of, say, one of the easy to get in and simple, but when they get some more confidential data, make it the ultimate analysis.
Yeah, by default, it is possible. So if you go to our the website, we have samples as we call it as a step-in authenticators. That means application can decide whenever required. So please increase this. This is offered. Yes, basically, this is what happened. If you can use API Manager EI. So whenever user come to authentication, usually it redirect user to identity server. Then identity server perform this whatever the security and give the token back. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Exactly. Yes. Yes. This is a pretty much standard use case we have supported. Yes.
Question from the middle.
Sorry. Can you? I think as a WSO2, so we are not really provide any facial or any biometric things. We have worked with, but we have connectors, right? So we have worked with several e-government projects. So they want this the fingerprint and the facial recognition technologies. So there are various vendors. Some of the vendors they claim like most of the cases they have proprietary algorithm. Kind of situation. So other than that, but we have seen people use that, even our customers. So I would say like so it is mature enough to use in production, but I don't have kind of, since we are not operate on that area, I can't say 100% it's mature. But there are production-ready service providers that even we have worked with. So. Yeah. Yes.
And even facial recognition.
Yes, so there are a lot of areas going on. Like we have seen that there's a new vendor they are working with something called the continuous authentication. That is, they study the way you type, right, and matches the previous the history. And if they decide somebody else now operate on your machine, they can block something like that. There are a lot of research are going on. Most of the cases, these are like proprietary technologies, or we only can see some research papers once they published. So. So who is the vendor?
Apple. So we use Apple.
Okay.
We used Apple iPhone sort of face, so it's an extension of what the gentleman said.
Yeah, I think so. That's again, so you have to evaluate with your internal security teams. That is good enough. So most of the cases, like if your end users are like random set of people, like social networker, most of the cases that's good enough. But if it is kind of a banking sector, like you mentioned, I don't know, because your internal security team should approve this is as secure enough.
I think my question is, have you worked with Apple do you have a plugin for it, or is there a way of integrating to it yet?
So there are some libraries and some to that we have integrated, but not directly with the identity server.
We can take one more question. If not, we can get on with the next session.
The adaptive authentication, does it require any additional component, or the IAM is more than enough?
Like I mentioned, if you are evaluating that context, background, basically the request context, or if you are just evaluating the user attribute, you don't need. But if you want to evaluate risk score, right, based on some risk engine or CEP, then we have to be integrated with that system. So depending on your requirement. Most of the cases, so the bank and et cetera, they have risk engine, right? That's not for a particular application, but that is centralized for whole bank. So they have several application, and they look for your credit history, and they maintain some kind of a risk score, right? So in such a scenarios, we have to integrate with those engines. That's depend on use cases. But if it is just user attribute, or if it is just request context, then the identity server is good enough. There's one more question.
Yeah, I think we can take one more question. Yeah.
Yeah, it should be a quick question. It's about, let's say we have in a company different applications different service provider. Is it possible to configure different adaptive authentication for each of the service providers?
Yes, yes. Okay. Yes. It's actually another step up. We have the multi-factor authentication. This is one additional step for multi-factor authentication. Earlier it was static, now you can make it dynamic. Yes.
Okay, thanks.
All right, great.